Welcome, Magic players, to another Pops Culture video with Dr. Magic and good friend Josh Fisher. We're going to cover something a little different today. Normally we do deck techs, which we talk about a deck that's been built, about how the cards came together, and how they get played. Today we want to take on something new, and that is brewing. So we've called this section How You Brewin'. If you're, you know, Friends, the TV show, you can do it with the Joey Tribbiani accent. How you brewing? But the idea here is to show you folks, like, what a brew looks like. How do you go from idea to finish, and kind of what that looks like. It's something that, you know, I've been playing for 20 years that I've just kind of always done and can just kind of do by look. But there really is some work, some art, a little bit of science.
Sure, absolutely.
Some voodoo thrown in to making a decent deck. So
Behind the scenes.
Yep. And even as in-depth as we can get today, there's still, you know, once you get it done, you got to test it and make some changes and see how it works. And so we can get a good idea and refine the idea, but we're still not done. But we're going to go through that part here. Now, normally these days, if I'm brewing, I'm brewing on a computer.
Sure.
I like to use MTG Vault. That's my personal. It's got all the cards.
I do a lot more on my phone than I do on the computer, and there's an app called Deck Builder that I use, and that has all the things that we're going to talk about here, just in electronic form, which seems to be more user-friendly than pen and paper.
It does, but the nice thing about this is I can show people how we do it.
Absolutely.
So we're going to go old school here.
Let's do it.
Like, the internet crashes tomorrow, global satellites fall from the sky, you can still brew a deck.
You can still play Magic the Gathering
Thursday
by
night
candlelight.
Modern. That is right. I remember when creatures had snow-covered land walk both ways uphill. So here we go. So what we decided to do, we're going to do a Mardu deck in Modern. Okay, it's actually a deck that I've been thinking about building for a little while. I think it's an archetype that maybe doesn't get explored. For those of you who don't know, Mardu is white, black, and red. So white, black, and red. Three great colors that have a lot of great spells, but don't see this combination a lot.
There doesn't seem to be a whole lot of synergy with a lot of the different archetypes. But I think the one that we're going to cover today, there's quite a bit where you have the control and you also have the ability to go wide with red and white in particular.
Right. You know, it's we see some white black tokens. We see some, you know, some black red occasionally weird discard. Nobody has fun deck. you know, obviously black and red are pretty prominent in Jund.
Sure.
White and black prominent in Junk. But these three together. So we want to kind of do a Mardu tokens build and see what we can exploit out of these colors. And we talked about this. You know, I can tell you right now from what we're trying to do, pack rat doesn't fit what we're trying to do.
Absolutely not.
But we're brewing.
Exactly.
We're brewing,
and
so
you may find out later on that you want to do Mardu tokens, but you kind of want to do it a little more around pack rat just because he is such an all-star. Not saying that that's the way we're going to go, and just by looking at it, I don't think we're going to, but it's never a bad idea to throw ideas out.
True.
And then you may change your mind on the deck later on. And as you're testing, again, you may find that this doesn't quite work, but, you know, my initial idea, you still have this paper to go back to kind of maybe revamp the deck again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when I'm building decks on MTG Vault, this is how I do it. You know, based on what I'm trying to build, I throw everything into the deck as a one-of, and then as I decide against it, I drop it into the sideboard.
Right, this way you still have access
to
the ideas.
Yeah, I put it back up,
and
yep, don't have to go back through. So, again, we're doing this kind of old school, so writing it down is great. I mean, he's asking me questions. This guy's ripping them out of my skull.
Okay. All right. Fair enough.
I think this one's a great look at you know, the start, the framework of what we want to do for Mardu tokens. So we're going to move on here to the next step, and that is weeding this down, assigning numbers of these into the deck, and trying to start to get an idea of what our, you know, our final 60 is going to look like. So we're going to move on to that right now. All right, so we spent time, we assembled a list that is reflective of the strategy we want to, which is Mardu tokens in Modern. And now we've come to the point where we have to talk about what makes sense, what doesn't make sense, what synergizes, what doesn't synergize. Right, in Modern, we're going to be 22 to 23 lands, right? Kind of a mid-range deck. Most of this, sure. If you guys haven't caught on yet, we're going to curve out probably at Lily and Mentor.
Which is three, but again, like we've referred to before, we want to be able to do multiple things. We want to be able to drop two instants in a turn so that we get triggers off of Young Pyro and Monastery Mentor, especially in combat, just to throw out more tricks. So
yep.
We want to be ultimately on board somewhere between 4 and 5 lands, and 22 to 23 gives us that ability.
Correct. And so that's going to leave us, what, 38 to 37 cards?
Sure.
38 to 37 cards. Okay, so 38 to 37 cards. So let's start looking at this. So this is our initial brood list. We took our initial list, which was just to start and to populate those fields. Then we've, you know, really whittled it down by talking about, you know, synergies and strategies, which is always the important thing. You know, we crossed off some really good cards, but we crossed them off for some very, very valid reasons. You know, Pack Rat and Rabble Master and Dark Confidant, nobody's going to dispute that those are really good cards. That's what we're trying to do. There's a lot of ways to win in Magic.
Sure.
You got to pick one, right? Like, I'm going to bill you out. I'm going to go wide. Am I going to get one big creature and try to, you know, do it that way? Am I going to infect you out? Am I going to...
Sure.
Whatever. And so this is the way we've chosen to build this deck. And so I think that these cards really support it. So once we have this part of the deck done, what we really need to look at is how do we make it run? And that comes to the mana. So we're going to move on here real quick. I'm going to swap pieces of paper here. And we're going to try to brew up a mana base. We took all our chicken scratch and made more chicken scratch. This is the revised list, including casting costs of everything we want to include in the deck. Again, we're getting started. Some of these numbers may change with testing, but we're here. We counted these up, and we ended up with 37 spells. For those of you who don't know, if it's not a land, it's a spell. I've given that advice to people before, and be like, it is a dozen spells, and they're like, I don't have a dozen spells. I'm like, well, everything's a spell. Even a summon spell is a spell. So 37 spells, so we're looking at 23 lands. So you're going to say you're going to run 7, 8, 6.
That's what I would do at this point. But again, there's a reason why I dislike this part of it. I'm not typically successful in the first time, and it takes quite a bit of playing before I actually figure out where my land base needs to be.
You know what? I don't disagree with you. And the next step of this really is looking at, like, where are you heavy, right? And we're heavy in black.
Yep.
With double blacks. Mm-hmm. And that's... or black dependent. We have to have black to cast Sorin.
Sure, and Thalsi's and Inquisition, you want to have a black source turn one.
And Flashback on Souls.
And Flashback on Souls.
So we look at that, and then we go, okay, so what's the next most important color for us to have good and early?
I guess I would probably say white. You want to be able to path. But then again...
I disagree.
You got to have red to play your turn two.
So got to have red to play your turn two. So when I look at these and I go, all right, so how am I looking at lands? What lands am I going to run? I sometimes hesitate to even put a mountain in, because my biggest concern is like getting Blood Mooned, and then everything's a mountain, so what do I care?
Yeah, that's kind of my fault too. I think maybe you leave that one mountain spot open for maybe a utility land.
Okay, so how about this for a utility land? I really like this.
I like it a lot. And again, there's only one step left at this point. You've figured out your numbers for everything. This is how many of everything I want. This is the idea I'm going for. You know, like you said, there's so many ways to win in Magic. This is the one that we've chosen.
Yep.
Go wide and just overwhelm your opponent and control their board state while advancing your own. I like it a lot. And at this point, it's just...
Go wide, young man.
Put it together and test it.
That's right.
And that's where... Just spending time piloting your deck is crucial at this point, because you have to figure out where things are good. You have to design your sideboard based on the meta that you play in.
Right.
You know, even if you're building modern deck to sit around the kitchen table and play with friends, you still have to know, you know, what decks are you going to be playing against.
That kitchen table is your meta. I wrote an article about
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
Like, that's your meta.
Exactly.
And people, we talk about meta, we kick it around. You and I have been playing for a long time. Ah, what's the meta? The meta changed. That deck's bad in the meta. Yeah, well, if I'm brand new, what the heck is the meta?
Exactly.
Do I have to invest in those too? You know, like after I buy my cards and my sleeves
right,
and my
now
box, I'm going to buy a meta.
No.
It's what you're playing against. Right.
Sure.
And that's why we don't really try to tackle sideboards a lot, even when we do deck techs, because it is meta dependent.
Absolutely.
It is,
and
some of it's playstyle dependent.
Sure. And you go to an FNM and you're playing against all homebrews, your sideboard is going to be completely different than when you go play in an IQ.
Yep.
When you go play in an IQ, you have to have tier one sideboard answers. It's just that simple. And for this deck, there are those. But again, it's not worth really getting into, because it's going to depend on where you're playing. I like the main board that we have right now,
yep.
And the engine that we have is solid.
Yep. And it gives us great, those colors give us great sideboard options. You know, if you're talking about sideboard, we talked about Terminate, we talked about Dreadbore. You know, Slaughter Games is nothing to sleep on in a world
sure.
where Scapeshift exists. White. Things like, you know, timely reinforcements. You could even grab more.
There's
you could,
even
you could
like
throw
like
another
Ancient
Thought
Grudge.
Seasons.
I mean,
yep,
if
Ancient
if
Grudge.
You're trying to go against Affinity. You know, there's just
Shatterstorm.
Sure, there's so many things.
Yep.
To talk about at this point, but
ley lines. Yeah, so you have access to some really good colors.
Sure,
Stony
absolutely.
Silence. I mean, so it like you said, it depends. What are you expecting to see in your local meta? What are you expecting to see on
sure.
a wider meta? And what does that mean for you? You know, we're talking about some personalized sideboard choices. Played in a Legacy tournament yesterday. Brett King, another player from here, and I were on the same deck. We both played Death and Taxes. Our main list is pretty similar.
Sure.
I remember one or two differences. Our sideboard couldn't have been more different. Outside
Absolutely.
Of like some Enlightened Tutors that like basically just, it was like, are we playing even playing the
sure.
same deck from looking at the sideboard? But he had things that he felt more comfortable and confident in using in certain matchups than I did. But I wanted to hedge against a different matchup, and that just comes down to like testing. Like I've played, I tested against this deck, and I'm weak here or strong here, and maybe he's played against a different deck and he's weak or strong. So who's right? I don't know. At the end of the day. You know, whichever one of you wins more, uses the sideboard more. But, you know, the fact of the matter is, if you make a solid deck, which comes from brewing and testing, the deck's going to be solid, and all you're really doing is adding some spice, some,
sure.
you know, shoring up some of the corners. And Modern's a really, really diverse place. And we have a lot of cards in here that don't discriminate, right? Like, well, Thoughtseize is good against this deck. No, Thoughtseize is just good.
Sure, absolutely.
You know, Bolt's just good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and pick a win con and go with it.
Lily is just good.
Just good.
You know, and I think that's one of the really nice things about being in black, white, red is that black, white, red just has good cards.
It's
good standalone cards. And when you can find things a lot like what we did here that just make that card better. I mean, in essence, we decided to make a Mardu Tokens deck, and I think that we did a really good job. I think we succeeded in our goal.
Yep.
But we also found ways that, you know, Thoughtseize is really good. IOK is really good. But now they're even better because now we're getting a Pyro trigger. And now we're getting a Monastery Mentors trigger and a Prowess trigger. And, you know, obviously, I mean, Bolt is the most played card in the format. It's good, right?
Yeah,
well,
it's good.
Well, now we've got ways that we get more value out of it, right?
I just made Bolt better.
You know, I really like the diversity of Mardu in this deck.
I do, too. This has been a lot of fun, folks. We went long. I don't know how much of this Nate is going to keep and cut. I'm going to talk to him, and hopefully he'll put up the full extended version if you want to listen to us rattle on for about an hour. You might find it useful. The fact of the matter is, Josh and I are both experienced players. We're comfortable in how the cards play, and both brought some of our ideas into this, and I felt like it was a really good synergy. Josh, really appreciate your time sitting down, helping me with this, getting a look at this, and having some input, and maybe one or two of us will build this and see how it goes.
Sounds good. Well, I appreciate you having me.
All right, folks. This has been Dr. Magic with the first ever How You Brewin' here. Once again, thanks to Josh Fisher for joining us. You please follow Pops on our Facebook page, our Twitter, our website. Sign up for the email. We're always posting deck techs and blog posts. Also, go to Patreon and support what we do there, and we'll keep these videos coming for you. Everybody have a great day.